Good evening and welcome to your Monday, April 8, 2024 edition of the Evening News. I am Jemima Holmes. Thank you for joining us. Let's take a look at some of the lead stories tonight. ICJ could now make informed binding judgment. Guyana welcomes Venezuela's border case submission. Man murders wife, then commits suicide. 13-year-old daughter makes gruesome discovery. Exciting new programs this term, says Manichan, as schools reopen. Man discharged from National Psychiatric Hospital, left in custody of minor, now missing. And PAC calls for special probe, as 111 million in drugs for Region 2 cannot be accounted for. Now for the news, in detail. The government of Guyana has welcomed Venezuela's decision to submit its counter-memorial on the border controversy to the International Court of Justice on Monday, the very last day the World Court had given Venezuela to do so. Here is Gerald Bryan with our lead story tonight.
Venezuela's last-minute submission of its counter-memorial to the International Court of Justice, ICJ, has been welcomed by Guyana and the region. In a statement, the government of Guyana noted the benefits of Venezuela's submission, one of which is that it allows the court to make an informed, binding decision on the case. According to Guyana, the ICJ now has submissions from both states and can take all arguments and evidence into account before it issues its final judgment. Repeated calls were made not only by Guyana, but also the international and regional community for the reluctant Venezuela to participate in the proceedings. Meanwhile, both the Caribbean community, CARICOM, and the Organization of American States, OAS, have issued statements condemning Venezuela's most recent provocative actions. Specifically, Venezuela's promulgation of a law for the defense of Essequibo in its National Assembly was condemned as infringing on Guyana's sovereignty. According to the OAS, regional peace and security depend on stopping the Venezuelan regime from advancing these threatening objectives. Meanwhile, CARICOM urged Venezuela to refrain from further actions that threaten peace in the region and to adhere to dialogue and international law. Over the weekend, the Commonwealth similarly rejected Venezuela's latest actions. The controversial law was promulgated at the instigation of Venezuelan President Nicolas Maduro in his bid to establish Guyana's sovereign Essequibo region as a state within his country. Jarrell Bryan, The Evening News.
A 69-year-old man yesterday murdered his 56-year-old wife and then committed suicide. The gruesome discovery was made by the couple's 13-year-old daughter, who alerted neighbors for assistance. Dead are Sarah Bacchus Arjun and Kemraj Arjun, who resided at Rec Dorsey, West Demerara. Police said the incident occurred at their residence between the hours of 11 hours 30 and 15 hours 30. Investigations so far revealed that the daughter returned home to find her mother lying in a pool of blood on the bedroom floor and her father gasping for breath on the bed. The teenager alerted neighbors, who alerted the police. Upon arrival at the crime scene, detectives found a note reportedly implicating the woman in an alleged affair. The note was written on a piece of cardboard. At the scene, the detectives questioned the husband, who admitted to ingesting poison and directed the ranks to the bottle, which contained the lethal substance. The ranks also found a murder weapon, a knife. The wife was pronounced dead at the scene, while the husband was taken to the West Demerara Regional Hospital, where he died whilst receiving medical attention. Meanwhile, a 70-year-old man who had been deported from the USA over a decade ago was last evening found dead on the parapet in front of his home at Middle Road, La Penitence, Georgetown. Clinton Chase, who was unemployed, was found dead at around 22 hours 30. The man's granddaughter told the detectives that she received a call from an unknown number informing her that her granddad had fallen from his motorcycle. Upon arriving at the scene, the granddaughter found the man motionless on his back, and as such, she called the EMT. Wounds were seen to his jaw, upper left arm, and chest. He was pronounced dead at the scene. The Evening News understands that the man was shot, but a post-mortem examination is scheduled to be conducted. At the time of his demise, the elderly man was living alone. Michael Henry joins us now to report that majority of schools across the country have reopened today following the Easter holiday break, and according to Education Minister Priya Manickchand, exciting new programs can be expected this term. Here are the details.
In a social media post on Monday, Education Minister Priya Manickchand revealed that as schools reopen this term, 99% of teachers in schools are either trained or in training. Moreover, she said the ministry's Breakfast for Success program is being extended to pupils in grade 5. As a result, some 26,254 pupils in grades 5 and 6 in schools across all coastline regions will receive a nutritious breakfast. Further, nursery and primary pupils residing in the hinterland are receiving daily hot meals. Manachan explained that the following programs are vital, especially since grade 6 students are preparing to sit the national grade 6 assessment in 3 weeks' time, and in just about a month, Caribbean Secondary Education Certificate and Caribbean Advanced Proficiency examination begins. Meanwhile, Grove and Timeri primary schools will reopen on Tuesday and Wednesday, respectively. According to the Education Ministry, a pest control treatment is being spearheaded at the Grove Primary School, while the Timeri Primary School is an active shelter for residents of Santa Mission and Santa Aratak, Region 3, Essequibo Islands, West Demerara, who were recently evacuated due to raging wildfires. Director General of the Civil Defense Commission, Colonel Nazrul Hussein, has indicated via telephone that the commission is setting up alternative shelters for the residents, which they will utilize until their community is safe for occupancy. Michelle Henry, The Evening News.
A man who was discharged under questionable circumstances from the National Psychiatric Hospital and left in the custody of a minor is now missing. In light of this incident, stakeholders are calling on authorities to pay closer attention to the operations of that facility, situated at Fort Kanji, Region 6. Our Burbies correspondent, Andrew Carmichael, tells us more.
On Thursday last, a 49-year-old man who had been a patient of the National Psychiatric Hospital for well over 10 years was dropped off at the home of a cousin, a 16-year-old girl. The man previously lived in New Amsterdam with his mother, but during his time at the institution, his mother passed away. The house he lived in is now abandoned. The Evening News understands that a staff at the hospital took him to a house at Greater New Amsterdam where the 16-year-old girl was at home. The teen was asked if she knew the 49-year-old man, and she said it was her cousin. As such, the staff left the man in the child's custody and departed. The teen, in the presence of her mother, recounted what transpired.
Well, I went in her mom and see the bus stop. So, when I get up, the person come out, a girl in the body, and I see you walk in, standing right there. And the girl asks, with Grace, which is my mother, and he asked him what she did. So I said she just got out on the road. I said okay. Then he asked for my father, which is back. So I said he got to work, and she said I know this man. I said yeah, I know the face. Then I said Sheldon. He said yes, and he was like yeah, she know me. And she just said get discharged. And he's not mad. He needs to come out from there and take his medication, and that was it.
Meanwhile, the teen's mother said arrangements were made to have the man sent to another relative on the East Bank of Berbice. However, the patient has since gone missing. Family members have since reported to the police that a 49-year-old man cannot be found and his whereabouts are unknown. Meanwhile, also on Thursday last, another man who was a patient at a hospital was dropped off at a relative's home. That man had been sent to the facility by a magistrate 10 years ago after he was deemed unfit to stand trial. According to the sister, she received a telephone call from the institution at about 10 hours on Thursday, informing her that her brother was discharged from the institution, and 4 hours later he was dropped off and left in the custody of her 15-year-old daughter.
I wasn't at home, and my kids were alone at home.
How old is the oldest? Young, the oldest, eldest?
The eldest one is 20. And that she received him, she didn't answer, is the 15-year-old is one, so. And the girl didn't ask no question. All she asked is if Sherry Adams living here, and he said yes. She didn't ask if I'm at home or anything. She just opened the bus door, put the patient out on the bridge, gave him his bag. By the time the eldest one could have come out to ask her, why is it she dropping him here, or I'm not at home, or whatever it is, she trying to build a conversation with her. She just jump in the bus, lock the bus door, and the bus drive off and leave him standing there.
The patient, whom family members say is violent, is reportedly living on the streets now. Reports are that at least two other patients were discharged from the institution last week and have no relatives around. They too are living on the streets in New Amsterdam since last week.
The way they go about dealing with these patients is very wrong. At least give the family a heads up. Meaning, like, you call, say, this is the protocol, this is what we're about to do, and we call in to say, well, in the next 2 to 3 weeks or whatever, we're going to release the patient. At least the family have enough time.
Last year, it was reported that the government is considering the closure of the National Psychiatric Hospital. Minister of Health, Dr. Frank Anthony, had contended that the act of institutionalizing persons in need of mental care does not occur anywhere else in the world, and it should not happen in Guyana either. Andrew Carmichael, The Evening News.
During a sitting of the Public Accounts Committee on Monday, confusion regarding what happened to $111.5 million that was supposed to go towards procuring drugs in Region 2 prompted calls from the committee for a special investigation into drug procurement in other regions as well. Gerald Bryan reports.
In his 2019 report, the Auditor General had found that an interdepartmental warrant for $210.1 million was issued to the Ministry of Health to procure drugs on behalf of Region 2. A subsequent financial return had indicated that all money was spent. When reconciliation was done in August 2020, however, only $98.5 million in drugs had been delivered. During Monday's sitting of the PAC, former regional executive officer Dennis Jaikaran was questioned as to what efforts were made to account for the missing $111.5 million. Jaikaran, who caused consternation among some members of the PAC due to the presence of PNCR paraphernalia on his person, claimed that he fully cooperated with the materials management unit.
I am answering the question from Madam Tishira, what efforts were made when I was there? And so I'm saying clearly the efforts that were made, that we continue when we would have made those available sums of money to the Ministry of Finance. The RHO would have been in regular contact with MMU to allow for her to be able to do the reconciliation and whatever would items would have received to make the necessary recording.
Meanwhile, PAC members Juan Edgel and Dr. Vishwa Mahalio both urged the audit office to do a further investigation and try to make contact with the regional health officer at the time.
We need to get clarity, so we need to work both with the MMU, that is Ministry of Health MMU, and the region. I think we also need to get the RHO because Dr. Ranjiv Singh is saying he's starting in 2020. We need to get the RHO, who was in 2019, and the former REO to see if we can clarify all of this.
The layman listening to this would say, if the Ministry of Health is standing by their documentation, and they sent full $210 million worth in drugs to the region, and the region could only account for $98.5 million, then there is drugs circulating somewhere else in the region.
Meanwhile, PAC member Gail Teixeira went even further, calling for a special investigation into other regions and their drug procurement.
The same problem occurs in 2020 for Region 2, and that in fact, there was no reconciliation done at all. So that's why I'm recommending that the Auditor General consider having a special investigation to look into this. He may first of all want to convene a meeting with the Ministry of Health and the regions who have been experiencing this, including Region 2, with the FS to try to see where was the problem. Because these letters being sent by Health saying the money was expended gets very confusing. Because one could think that the money was expended but used in other areas like public hospital or regions, but the letters seem to say it was expended in those particular regions. So that I think that we can't go much further here, but that I think it is time that maybe the Auditor General does a special investigation to reconcile.
Jarrell Bryan, The Evening News.
Coming up, millions worth of crops destroyed after a weedy site used to spray canals at Bath Settlement, and Region 7 residents undergo hernia gallstone surgeries at Kamarang Hospital. Do stay with us. More news ahead.
Transitions Light Intelligent Lenses. Pick your color. Choose your style. Available at Optique Vision Care.
Micro, small, medium enterprises can expect significant support in 2024. The sum of $450 million was allocated to the Small Business Development Fund and $331 million for the Small Business Bureau. This will provide for the disbursement of 100 loans and 1,362 grants to businesses. Additionally, 2,800 businesses will receive training in apiculture, farming, livestock, poultry rearing, and microenterprise. This and more are initiatives of the 2024 national budget, which is being supported by revenues earned from oil production.
Looking to bring your dream home to reality? Or simply taking on a home improvement project? Then National Hardware Limited is where you should start. Let us put that touch to your home. Choose from over 1,000 Berger Paint Original Hues for any surface. We are known for our trusted brands such as Westinghouse, Philips, Sadco, Rubbermaid, Pyrex, Gibson Home, and so much more. National Hardware Limited, your do-it-best store. Located in downtown Georgetown and industrial site Rhymeville.
This Mother's Day, celebrate in style and give mom the chance to win big. Simply top up with $1,000 or more for a chance to be one of five lucky winners of a brand new, fully stocked French door fridge with groceries worth over $550,000 each. One winner will be selected weekly from April 5th to May 9th. Start topping up today. Digicel, the network for everyone, everywhere.
Did you know that when you leave your property unoccupied and unmanaged, it deteriorates much faster than you can imagine? Then, before you know it, much of your hard-earned investment is wasted. At Hand in Hand Trust Corporation, property management is our business. Whether you travel for long periods, live overseas, or have several properties that require managing, let us at Hand in Hand Trust Corporation take care of this for you. Your property is safe with us. Hand in Hand Trust Corporation Incorporated, a member of the Hand in Hand Group of Companies.
Electrical contractors, builders, and homeowners. When it comes to electricals, don't take chances. Invest in top quality electrical items from our electrical department at Gafoos. We stock brands from the USA, Canada, and the UK, such as Cooper Allied and Siemens. Get main and distribution circuit panels and breakers in various sizes. Electrical cables in sizes ranging from 1.5 millimeters to 16 millimeters in single core, flat, and ground flex. Surface and flush switches ranging from 1 gang to 6 gang. Also double pole switches from 20 amps to 45 amps. Outlets 13 amps to 20 amps, both surface and flush. Earth rods and clamps 6 inches to 10 inches. Also available are transformers, voltage regulators, and more. So for all your home and office and industrial electrical items, visit the Gaffer's location nearest you at MacDoom, Parika, Neems, Land of Caleb, Rose Hall, Beattie, Kanji, and...
The moment is coming. He has the ball. Will he make the shot? And he made it! Goal! This is the biggest win we've seen in ages. Feel the rush with every bet and win big. Play online at www.ibetgamesui.com.
With iBet Supreme, every game is your game. I bet to win with iBet Supreme.
Must be 18 years and older to bet.
Welcome back. You're watching the evening news. Attorney General and Minister of Legal Affairs Anil Nandlal has defended the government's decision to approach the Caribbean Court of Justice after the Court of Appeal would have rejected their efforts to join the ExxonMobil oil spill insurance case. Here are the details from Gerald O'Brien.
It was recently revealed that the government of Guyana had approached the Caribbean Court of Justice, CCJ, after its efforts to join the oil spill insurance case against ExxonMobil had been rejected. According to Attorney General Anil Nandlal, not making the state a party to a case that deals with a contract it is already a party to, as well as a case that would have huge impact on the state, is a violation of natural justice.
Under physical, economic, financial, and social transformation, largely driven by revenues that is being derived or that are being derived from the sector under that very agreement. All the physical expansions taking place in the country, all the infrastructural work taking place in the country, all the highways, all the bridges that are being built, all the hospitals, all the housing drive, etc. This oil and gas contract is connected to all of that, and the revenues from this sector is connected to all of that, or are connected to all of that. In other words, this sector is critical to the public good and critical to the developmental agenda of our country.
He further pointed out that Ghana's legislation allows for any citizen to institute legal proceedings or to be joined in those proceedings. This, he noted, is without exception. Then there is the Petroleum Activities Act, which mandates that the state should be a party in any case that could see the petroleum industry being put at risk.
Under the new Petroleum Activities Act, we have inserted a provision that these cases, when they are filed, the state must be made a party. Because one of these sectors can be shut down and government is not heard. Now, this case was filed in relation to the financial assurance that was not lodged by the oil company. The state was not made a party. The government of Guyana was not named as a party. Now, the Environmental Protection Agency alone was named. The government is a party to the contract, as I said. How can you take a case to the court in relation to this contract, in relation to operations under this contract, in relation to the license issued under the contract, and you are not naming the government as a party?
Last year, the High Court had ruled that ExxonMobil must provide unlimited insurance for its offshore oil operations in the Stabroek Block. Both the EPA and Exxon have since appealed this decision, and it is now before the Court of Appeal. Gerald O'Brien, The Evening News.
Some cash crop farmers at Bat Settlement, West Coast Berbice, Region 5, are counting their losses after using water contaminated with weedicide to water their crops. Additionally, some livestock farmers have lost some of their animals after being fed grass that was sprayed with a deadly weedicide, and in some cases, the animals drank the contaminated water. The farmers are claiming that the Guyana Sugar Corporation, Gaisuko Blairmont Estate, would have used the weedicide to kill the vegetation growing in one of its canals running through Bat Settlement. Cash crop farmers used the water from the canal to water their crops. Other farmers of the same community claim that the Bat Wood Park NDC would have undertaken a similar exercise. Our Burmese correspondent Andrew Carmichael has that story.
These farmers cultivate mainly shallot, tomato, and celery. More than a dozen of them have been affected. In fact, about half of that, very close to a dozen, are even working with the Guyana Sugar Corporation, Gaisuko. But these farmers say that that corporation would have sprayed some of the drains, and the NDC would have also sprayed some of the drains, putting poison into the system, which they would have used to water their gardens.
My whole garden is here shallow, and me use the water where them spray the trench and me water the shallow, and the whole garden gone down, wiped down.
Like, how much money you think you lose?
Well, my whole garden, when me sell them, when me reap my whole garden and sell them, I just make $1 million from it. We whole garden, we plant with shallot, full with shallot, as you can see. I call him from help, he need some help. It's very hard for me now because when I get an income from Norway. The NDC them, I send the workers them to weed the trench and didn't weed in trench. They come and spray the trench. When we call the NDC, that let them come and see what damage me had, what they can do about it. Them say they go call the chairman, and when we call back them, they tell me, said the chairman said that how me got to call sanitary. Me want to know what sanitary can do about this with me. No one coming till now, since me call them about 3 to 4 weeks now, no one coming considering nothing about me but my garden.
Meanwhile, several animal farmers have lost sheep and goat. Mahindranath Sukri, who lives at Waterloo Bat Settlement, is both a cash crop and a livestock farmer who gets grass from a canal for his animals. According to him, on March 27th, he asked someone to cut a bag of grass for him.
Me saw them on the morning with the can, but me not knowing that them was going and spray the trench. So me went and tell the boy, cut a bag of grass for me. So he now observed, said the man, I go spray. And he go and cut the grass. And when he cut the grass, he bring it give me. So me give the big ram the grass. So nobody now knows said them spray the trench. So when he realized that the trench spray the next morning, somebody tell him, don't cut the grass, said the trench spray. Then he around come tell me, said it, what me do with the grass? Me say me don't give the sheep the grass. Now when me go in the pen, the ram the pan the last lap. Me can't do nothing to save it.
Sukri said about 6 sheep died and he believes that they would have drank water from the canal. The ram, he says, cost $200,000.
So I was asking if they could give me back something for buy back one, because I got to purchase one now.
There have been repeated calls by government officials, including Agriculture Minister Zulfikar Mustafa, for contractors to desist from spraying waterways with chemicals and to stick to manual cleaning of those infrastructures. Meanwhile, other cash crop farmers utilize the canal to water their crops said they are feeling the brunt of the contaminated water as they are losing large amounts of income. Mahesh Jagdeo, who has just over 1 acre under cultivation at Plantation Hope Railway Line, is one such farmer. He cultivates shallot, celery, and tomatoes. What happened?
Apparently, guys, who they spray the irrigation canal, the outlet that they normally drain water in, and the residue, we pump in the water into our field, and the chemical get in contact with the plant. And it, you could see, as you could see the evidence is here, it the plant been dying out, the tomatoes, the shallot, the celery.
Some of the farmers told the Evening News that they made attempts to interact with the field manager of the Guyana Sugar Corporation, Blairmont Estate, even spending almost an hour and a half outside of his office, but he only came out and told them that he was too busy to meet with them. From Bat Settlement, West Coast Burmese in Region 5, for the Evening News, Andrew Carmichael.
Several residents of Region 7 are now relieved following the execution of 8 successful hernia and gallstone surgeries. The procedures were conducted at the recently constructed surgical theater at the Upper Mazaruni District Hospital, located in Kamarang. Trisha Sobers tells us more.
The hernia and gallstone surgeries were provided to Amerindians from Waramadong, Philippi, Camarang, and several other villages in Region 7. Consultant surgeon from the Georgetown Public Hospital Corporation, GPHC, Sheikh Amir, led the surgical team and support staff from GPHC, the Lethem Regional, and Mercy Hospitals. Many of the patients expressed gratitude to the team. One such person is Ramel Johnny, whose daughter underwent a successful operation. According to him, the surgical outreach has alleviated all expenses he would have paid for his daughter to travel to Georgetown.
We have been crying for this institution, I should say, this health sector. It's really helping a lot of people in this district. When I hear about these services coming to our district, I was very, very much happy to know that they were already here. So, and she was the first person or the first patient from the district.
Similarly, Colson Thompson, a resident of Waramadong, expressed relief that surgeries are now being done within the district and closer to home.
Many times I have suffered. I went to Georgetown. I couldn't find no fault in me. And only yesterday I had to find a fault that I was ill. I'm suffering with the hernia yesterday. And I had to end up in going to get a surgery. And I'm successful. I'm glad everything is safe right now.
Meanwhile, Director General at the Ministry of Health, Dr. Vishwa Mahadiu, explained that the initiative is part of numerous commitments made by President Dr. Irfan Ali in bridging the gap between the hinterland and the coastland. On this point, he disclosed that the medical teams, comprising surgeons from the Georgetown Public Hospital, will conduct outreaches at the Upper Mazaruni District Hospital every 3 months in a bid to improve healthcare in the region.
This is a case of bringing healthcare to the people, right? Because this region has also been doing specialist outreaches. This is how we know what to put in our budget. Because we come out, we meet with the people, we hear what are their concerns, what are their requests, sometimes what are their demands, and then we try to meet it. We try to ensure that the facilities that we have, the kind of staffing that we have, that it meets the requests, the demands, and then more importantly, the needs of the community.
The government and the Regional Democratic Council invested approximately $50 million in the construction and furnishing of the operational theater at the Camarang District Hospital. Trishel Sobers, Evening News.
A tug and a barge being used at the construction site of the new Demerara River Bridge drifted and crashed into the Demerara Harbor Bridge last night. The incident, which occurred at around 19:30, affected the bridge's operations, sparking immediate response efforts from authorities. Here is Trishel Sobers again with the details.
While the collision did not render the Demerara Harbor Bridge out of service, it prompted concerns regarding traffic flow and safety measures. Various teams, including the Ghana Defense Force Coast Guard and the Maritime Administration Department, were mobilized to address the situation. Plans were laid out for the removal of the barge once tide conditions were optimal, with a tug on standby for the maneuver. An investigation is currently being carried out by the Maritime Administration Department to determine the cause of the incident and whether the tug pushing the barge had sufficient control given its heavy load of steel plates. In a social media post, Public Works Minister Juan Edil disclosed that technical experts will also inspect the bridge and ensure it remains in good condition while the new bridge is being constructed.
Control situation as it relates to laden trucks. We are releasing them at intervals to ensure that the weight on the damaged section is minimal and we don't compromise anything further until we get to be able to do a full inspection. We're getting ready now to send down the divers to see exactly if the anchors have been dislodged and what needs to be done.
The minister also announced that the company responsible will have to pay for the repairs to the damages. In October 2022, a portion of the Demerara Harbor Bridge was damaged when the MV Tradewind Passion, a ship consigned by Guy Oil, to transport fuel crashed into the bridge. This resulted in two spans of the bridge shifting some 45 degrees out of alignment. In 2023, the spans were replaced following an investment of $1.2 billion made by the Ghana government. Trishel Sobers, Evening News.
The Ghana government has donated the sum of $72.5 million to United Nations Relief and Works Agency for Palestine Refugees in the Near East to provide immediate humanitarian relief for the people in Gaza and the occupied Palestinian territories. The monies were raised during a night of prayer for global peace, Guyana and Palestine, at the Ramadan Village. Here is Trishel Sobers once more with the details.
The Night of Prayer for Global Peace, Guyana and Palestine, saw the support of Guyana's Islamic community, government ministers, members of the diplomatic community, and the general public. The night's activities included several prayer sessions and a special Islamic program, among others. The $72.5 million in donations raised on Saturday evening was handed over to the United Nations Relief and Works Agency for Palestine Refugees in the Near East. UNRWA, which is the primary humanitarian agency in Gaza, with several million people depending on it for their daily survival. During his address at the event, President Dr. Irfan Ali disclosed that the monies provided did not include donations made directly into the bank account that was set up and will be handed over to the agency on a later date.
I think this is a historic night for Guyana and Guyanese. And let me be very clear, these resources were raised from every single community across our country. They were raised in small numbers and in larger numbers. But they were raised with love and charity. They were raised with the Guyanese spirit.
The head of state went on to reiterate calls for a ceasefire in Gaza, something which he had done on several international stages, including at the United Nations and the UN Security Council, as well as the Caribbean community, where President Ali is currently serving as the chairman.
This is genocide. It is the first publicly televised genocide in the world. It is nothing short of genocide. And it must stop. It must stop without condition. In our government, at the UN, would always have a paragraph to speak about Palestine and injustice in other places in the world. Guyana and the People's Progressive Party civic government has always been principled on matters like these.
In addition to calling for a ceasefire, the Ghana government back in February had pledged $150,000 towards the UNRWA in support of Palestinians displaced and affected by the ongoing conflict in Gaza. Sunday marked 6 months since the October 7, 2023 attack by Hamas on Israel, which has retaliated with an onslaught of violence that has persisted since, thus leading to the senseless loss of civilian lives, destruction of property, and displacement of persons in Gaza. Based on international reports coming out of Gaza, approximately 33,175 Palestinians have been killed and another 75,886 wounded, including some 13,000 children. Trishel Sobers, Evening News.
And now for a look at the bridge reports.
The Demerara Harbor Bridge will be closed to vehicular traffic on Tuesday, April 9, 2024 at 3 hours 30 for 1.5 hours. Meanwhile, the Berbice River Bridge is expected to be closed at 17 hours on Tuesday, April 9, 2024, also for 1.5 hours.
Milo round of 16 teams decided, and Sammy wants to see Joseph in T20s before considering World Cup selection. Details of these stories coming up in the Sportcast, sponsored by MACORP.
Premier Insurance Coverage. for less. Stay safe. Premier. Premier insurance coverage for less. Stay safe.
Be my decor. Stop the finest in the country. Both ceramic and porcelain. Tiles and chandeliers you'll see. While you shop around stress free. Well trained staff and warming halls. Make your shopping smooth and calm. Providing you with quality. To match your style is so unique.
Mechanics, Sylvie's has all the equipment you need to make your job easier and your business profitable. Visit our 31 High and Hatfield Street store and choose from our wide array of shop presses, engine hoists, oil drain pans, parts washers, jack stands, bottle and floor jacks, hand tools and much more. Can't make it to the store? Shop online at sylviesonline.com and have it delivered. Call or WhatsApp 623-7755 for more info.
This Mother's Day, celebrate in style and give mom the chance to win big. Simply top up with $1,000 or more for a chance to be one of five lucky winners of a brand new, fully stocked French door fridge with groceries worth over $550,000 each. One winner will be selected weekly from April 5th to May 9th. Start topping up today. Digicel, the network for everyone.
Did you know that Gassy's Jet A1 fuel is a type of aviation fuel specially formulated for turbine engines? Jet A1 fuel is safer to handle and transport than any other fuel types due to its high flash point and low volatility. It also boasts a high energy content, enhancing aircraft performance and efficiency. So whether traveling for business or pleasure, choose Gassy's Jet A1 fuel for a safe, reliable, and efficient flight.
The moment is coming. He has the ball. Will he make the shot? And he made it! Goal! This is the biggest win we've seen in ages. Feel the rush with every bet and win big. Play online at www.ibetgamesui.com. With